Todos y todas a esta sesión.
Welcome everyone to this session on public policies regarding jobs. Today we're going to reflect with four wonderful speakers about what are the most appropriate public policies when we are talking about promoting jobs for disabled people. A few months ago, the UN Committee for Disabled People provided some indications on the analysis and areas that we need to consider when analyzing job policies for people with disabilities, all public policies that we need to set forth so people with disabilities and everything linked to this in the job market can be an actual reality. In that document that is still being consulted, the committee already indicated a series of elements that we need to consider. We know that there's a high level of unemployment. We know that there are people with the right qualifications. There are right people. There's a lot of stigma for disabled people in the job place. However, specifically, the committee reflected on how these laws should be, all these public policies that affect people with disabilities. And they referred to education, professional training, retention of disabled people in the job place, and how public policies should adapt to fight against discrimination, make the process of hiring easier, and how we can start regulating the different hiring softwares that artificial intelligence uses, the biases, the different aspects of different websites, having these different training problems that are linked to the new ways of working that we all, disabled and non-disabled people, are facing. We need to start looking for what are the elements of public policies that we need to review when we talk about the future of jobs for people with disabilities. My name is Javier Güemes. Director of International Relations from Grupo Social 11. I'm also an international relation advisor. So we are going to talk today about public policies that affect disabled people. In Grupo Social 11, we've worked for many years in improving employment for disabled people in Spain and in other countries. From Fundación 11 that works with other European foundations for including disabled people in the job market and managing talent, but also other elements for other institutions with organizations in Latin America. And also through technical advisory for other organizations that we've been able to work in creating and improving public policies, for example, in Brazil. All of that rises to other features that we think are fundamental when we talk about employment for disabled people. In first place, we think that there should be right information about the state of disabled people in the job market. Many times we set strategies that don't have enough information to know where to direct them. Here we have in Spain an observation lab that observes how disabled people work in the job market. So we need to know what are the areas that we need to reinforce. What are the areas that disabled people may struggle when entering the job market that we need to know? It's a fundamental element when we get together as Grupo Social for disabled people. That is to value talent. That is a commonplace in many conferences, in many projects. We've started to find this continuum reference of talent of disabled people. And from that talent, we need to grow, not from disability. And we need to have a system, a structured system that allows to value how people with disabilities can enter the job market through their own talents and not their disability. It may seem simple, but it requires a structured work system when creating these kinds of interventions. The other thing that we need to see is that disabled people need to have the freedom of choosing what to do with their lives, that it is not determined by the public or any law. They need to have freedom when choosing where to form their career. But this is not so easy, right? A fourth element of the employment systems that ONCE believes crucial when promoting public policies is that we need to consider all employment models that can be aligned with this. It's fundamental that those mechanisms, as quotas and fiscal aspects that support companies that have a high percentage of disabled people in their staff, all of that we need so that the reality of the job market that is so complex can be more accessible for disabled people. I want to highlight that we as a group are the fourth employer in Spain, probably one of the most important in the world for disabled people, but always keeping in mind that we provide jobs for disabled people and non-disabled people. For example, we have a company that has 60% non-disabled, 40% disabled. So you can find this kind of talent in every level, from the directive teams throughout all the levels. It's important for disabled people to be included at all levels. Another element that for us is very important is to consider disability and everything around it, for example, as accessibility, as a fundamental element of the value chain of any company and any public policy that bets on accessibility, on inclusion. This has economic effects for companies and for public administrations. I also believe it's important to point out that when we talk about public policies, we don't have to reflect only, as the committee says, in some of the elements like companies or an intermediation system. So we need to consider all the ecosystem regarding inclusion in the workplace, from education to companies and going through the creation of public policies. This is an ecosystem that's intertwined. If we only add one aspect, we won't have a structural impact. Well, in this way, I would like to also point out that Grupo Social ONCE, based on that experience that we've had for many years in employment for disabled people in Spain, we've moved our experience to a project that we do with the Inter-American Bank for Development in different Latin American countries based on four main elements. One is that we should consider how to improve intermediation systems for disabled people through digital technologies, create business forums that have the possibility to create awareness of the needs of disabled people, and at the same time, is to create awareness for disabled people. If we don't act on those fronts through different observatories of jobs, we cannot do this project. It's called For Talent Latin America, and for around a year and a half, we've developed it in those four countries, and you can access to more information on this project. So that's my introduction within the framework of employment for disabled people, for example, with the project Grupo Social ONCE. And I would like to give the floor to our first speaker after this presentation. That's Antonio Martínez. He's Director of International Relations Advisor from APSA. He's also a university professor. And for over 15 years, he has a line of investigation with over 20 publications. That's the right of disability. He's patron and also participates in other projects that are also linked to Zero Project, where he was able to present and has a big impact when we have, when we talk about intellectual disability. So Antonio, you can have the floor so you can start your presentation.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much, Javier, for your presentation. And it is really a great pleasure for me to be able to intervene in this session. And I'm doing this just to present one of the most innovative processes. This is the penitentiary system program. And it's very much related to what Javier was saying about the policies of employment, as we are going to see now. So to give you some context about this, I would say that APSA is the organization of intellectual disabilities organization that is the most important one in Alicante, in the southeast of Spain. And currently APSA is working with more than 2,000 people with intellectual disabilities throughout their life, from childhood to the elderly stage. And we have more than 300 professionals. Well, one of the most innovative programs that we develop at APSA, specifically from 1995, is the penitentiary program. As you know, in Spain, as in many other countries, the people with intellectual disabilities that commit crimes, in many cases, they're not punishable. So in consequence, they do not go to jail, but they have to have some security measure. So generally, in many of the cases, and one of the most serious ones, are related to going into an institution. And they're there in that place that gets people that have psychosocial problems or also disabilities, mental disabilities. It is easy to suppose that these people have many discriminations, and that's specifically more difficult for them to be inserted socially. So we are working to promote the employment of people with disabilities, but also with people that generally have committed crime, and many times they come from unstructured families or different types of vulneration. So as I said before, there is a lot of possibilities to be discriminated here. So to answer to this kind of problems, we created the APSA penitentiary program. So what we want to do here is to help people, not just in an individual way to improve their quality of lives and their adaptations, but also give them a professional training that will allow them to be inserted in the different contexts that they're at. This is very interesting because one of the problems that you have when you need to deal with work insertion for this, for all of the people that have disabilities, it has to be good for us. Many times the people have deficiencies in their formation, in their training. So one of the best strategies to promote their insertability is by training. So this is what we do with mentally disabled people that are in the Alicante institution. So for that, we have two activities. On the one side, we have workshops, training workshops in the institution itself. And on the other hand, and this is maybe the most innovative part of the program, from the year 2001, we have been seeing which are the people that have better insertion possibilities. Of course, the penitentiary authorities give us their opinion. So they go out and they do some kinds of jobs. We train them professionally through experience. And that training is in three main areas. You have some pictures there. We have gardening and also manipulation and cleaning. This experience is particularly important because it makes the transition to be more, to be softer. these people that are convicted in an institution are going out every day to carry out a job. So they have a better transition into independent life, and that will allow to deal with better perspectives, their insertion, their social insertion afterwards. So to tell you about some figures, we have been working with more than 600 people from 1995, and currently the amount of people that we have there in the institution, there are 65 people, mentally disabled people. And of course, four people that finished their sentence between the years 2019 and 2020, and they went out of the institution, they found a job. So they are absolutely independent. And I think that this is very important. We can say that it's just four people, yes, but related to what we're talking about is very significant. The cost of the program is about 110 euros per year. They're financed by the regional government of the Valencian community and the Spanish government. So the government, the regional government, gives up 50%, and the government of Spain the other one. This system has been replicated in other places of Spain. We started in 1995 in Alicante, and we have two characteristics that I think are the most innovative ones and that allow us to qualify this program as a job program, as an employment program. So we offer the interns a professional training. And also, on the other hand, they have the possibility of going out of the institution to actually work in a more normal environment. This program is started in APSA, but throughout the years, it has been extended to other institutions in Spain. In Alicante, we have new challenges, and now we are broadening the range of the program. On the one side, we need to consider that the people with mental disability that are declared unimputable and that are in the program, we have other people that are punished, that can be prosecuted, and they go to prison. So in the Alicante jail, we are going to create a specific unit for intellectual disabled people that is denominated the Integra module, and APSA is going to be delivering the services there, the support services. And at the same time, we are going to have a program in the Alicante prison. This is going to be an early attention program for mothers that have a disability and that need help. This is called the Programa Madres. It has been an initiative from APSA, and it is a program that is absolutely pioneer. It has no presence whatsoever in other institutions in Spain. So we hope that this program is successful and that is fruitful for the people and also for the children that we are going to be helping, and that it can be replicated in other places of Spain, as it has happened with the original program. So to conclude, I would like to mention some comments that the participants of this program had said. And they have said that the training imparted by APSA has given sense to their lives because it has given them something to fight for, and it has allowed to end a type of life, a style of life that has meant only suffering. So I think that this testimony is really valuable and important. If we add that some of these people like Paco or Cesar, which are two of the last people that have been able to get a job after getting out of the institution, they had no support whatsoever. And they have found this network of support thanks to APSA. We have given them the opportunity of getting an opportunity, an independent life. I think that it is clear that this program, with all of the testimonies that we have seen, this is a program that is worth it, because this is what it's really, really significant and what it makes a real difference. It makes social inclusion possible. All of these people, or most of these people, come from marginal backgrounds. And of course, everyone with a disability, and also those that come from marginal environments, we need to try to involve them all. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias, Antonio, por la presentación.
Thank you, Antonio, so much for your presentation on this very interesting project. We will have the opportunity at the end of the blog to ask questions about this project. Now we will have an intervention by two people in the next part of the session, Nadia Mossburg and Katia Albanese. Nadia is Senior Policy Advisor of the Office of Disability Employment Policy from the U.S. Department of Labor. She has over 18 years of experience with the federal government. She directs this program with the letters SEED regarding advising people with disabilities with jobs, with modifications on their offices and transport. Joining her, we have Katia, Project Director of the State Employment and Disability Exchange of the same office. She has a degree on Business Administration by the American University of Washington. She's a communicator and specialist in government issues with over 15 years of experience. Currently working with concepts of the Office of Disability Employment in the United States Department of Labor. So, Katia and Nadia, I will give you the floor now.
Thank you so much to the Zero Project for recognizing our work and for inviting us here today to talk to you about pro-employment public policy initiative, the State Exchange on Employment and Disability, or commonly referred to as SEED. The U.S. Department of Labor's Office of Disability Employment Policy created SEED to help state and local policymakers implement inclusive workforce policies that address barriers and improve opportunities for all individuals in achieving employment success. It's a disability employment policy campaign, SEED, that promotes the enactment of meaningful state and local policies and best practices that lead to increased employment opportunities for people with disabilities and a stronger, more inclusive American workforce and economy. We are cross-disability in focus, meaning that we work to improve employment opportunities and outcomes for people with all types of disabilities. SEED works with leading intermediary organizations whose members are state and local government representatives to ensure they have the policymakers have the tools and resources they need to develop and implement grassroots level policy that advances employment success for people with disabilities. Next slide. SEED is truly unique in that it is the only federal, state, and local government collaborative that focuses on inclusivity and universally designed policy. This SEED model is responsive and flexible, which lends itself to great innovation and the ability to help improve the quality of opportunity and life for all Americans. Based on a formal evaluation, SEED was deemed a model for replication by other agencies. It's As a result, many have leveraged seats, structure, and recognition to collaborate on state-level policy. SEED's partnership strategy has been replicated at the local level, increasing the collaborative from 3 to 19 organizations. Next slide, please. SEED offers a number of types of policy assistance to states and localities, including expert level testimony, subject matter expertise, disability employment data, and connection with other federal agencies. The work of SEED and its primary resources, such as the Work Matters framework, have been replicated in 13 statewide action plans, and 48 states have enacted Work Matters policy options. SEED employs innovative strategies to promote the adoption of federal policies that maximize the impact by leveraging partners' unique strengths. And with that, I will turn it over to my colleague, Katia Albanese. Katia?
Thank you so much, Nadia, and thank you to the Zero Project again for having us here today. It's important to note that the Office of Disability Employment Policy and the United States federal government are not seeking to influence state legislation. Rather, SEED, our initiative, provides an avenue for state and local governments to request information to support their policy goals around the employment of people with disabilities. And through the provision of customizable options that account for these state and local government-driven interests and stakeholder needs, our novel approach has led to widespread policy adoption. And to date, SEED's work has led to state and local systematic change. And as Nadia mentioned, support to an enactment of policies in close to 50 states, 48 plus two territories, has resulted in more than 400 plus policies. And to help you understand the impact in the United States, in 2019, 39 states adopted 120 disability inclusive bills, impacting 30 plus million people with disabilities. And examples of these policies that have been established include establishing fast track hiring authorities to enable state agencies to more efficiently hire and promote qualified adults with disabilities, implementing centralized accommodation funds for state agencies, adding disability-owned businesses to states' minority-owned, women-owned, and small business procurement and contracting in order to provide disability-owned businesses with more opportunities for doing business with state government. Establishing, for example, the Office of Accessible Transportation and Mobility, an office focused primarily on ensuring accessible transportation and technology, and ensuring expanded competitive integrated employment opportunities in order to encourage and assist individuals with severe disabilities to achieve maximum personal independence through useful, productive, and gainful employment. SEED has grown from working with 3 to 19 state and local intermediary organizations, which Nadia mentioned earlier, that benefits more than 7,000 state legislators, 50 governors, 50 lieutenant governors, 1,400 mayors, 3,000 county officials, and more than 50,000 staff. And our resources are available to assist them in the work that they do. And of these policymakers, our champions, the policymakers that we work with, have enacted policies to help reduce the barriers and increase employment opportunities. And in turn, helping us narrow the overall employment gap from 41.2% in 2005 to 40.3% in 2018. The SEED model is rooted in flexibility and timeliness. And recently, SEED has worked with numerous states and localities to assist in protecting vulnerable populations and implementing telework, among other accommodations in the face of the COVID-19 pandemic. In November 2020, our SEED initiative launched a COVID-19 policy collaborative for an inclusive recovery, also known as just the collaborative, to support SEED partners and other stakeholders in their respective pandemic responses and to ensure newly implemented policies align with disability and civil rights laws and policies in the United States. Information and data that was gleaned from the collaborative activities helped to develop a series of new resources. The collaborative hosted a series of virtual convenings as well that were focused on returning to the workplace, workforce retention, and preparing for work. And priority issues that were covered included inclusive safety and health policies, telework, mental health, equitable COVID-19 vaccine access and distribution, and workforce readiness. And as a result of this collaborative, as I mentioned, several resources were created, including the frameworks for a disability inclusive recovery, which is a guide that highlights these important topics I just mentioned and help to ensure that disability inclusive recovery and also provides a series of coinciding policy frameworks with policy options and examples in action already in the states to assist our state and local policymakers in their efforts to adopt disability-inclusive COVID-19 recovery initiatives. And given COVID-19's impact on employment, as well as the changing nature of work in the workforce, our SEED initiative will continue to support policymakers to ensure newly implemented policies are inclusive and, again, align with the United States disabilities and civil rights laws and regulations. And with that, our contact information is on the screen, and we encourage you to please reach out to us with any questions or requests for resources, and also please encourage you to visit our website.
Muchas gracias, Nadia y Katia, por esta presentación.
Nadia y Katia. Thank you very much for your presentation. It's very interesting. I am sure that this is improving policies and not just in the United States. So I would like to give the floor to Laura Diego. Laura Diego, she is the head of regulation in the National General Direction of Public Policies for People with Disabilities in Spain. She is in charge of the public policies for inclusive employment. She has participated in all of the editions of Zero Project and in two of them that were for fostering employment from the Ibero-American organization. So I think that she is a great professional, and I would like to give you the floor to start. So Laura, please go ahead. Thank you very much, Javier, for your presentation, and thank you very much, Zero Project, for inviting me to present the experience of the National General Direction for the Implementation of Public Policies. In Spain, the public policies for the people with disabilities are led through the state from our area. In the works that we do, we propose and elaborate the normative in equal access for the people with disabilities. Apart from that, as a disability is something overarching, we also participate in the elaboration of regulations in different areas. And we work with different ministries to be able to work with the people with disabilities. So another thing that we do is that we design the strategies in terms of disabilities. So the strategy in Spain for disability and the action plan We have been taking the framework of reference of all of the public policies that are carried out in Spain. In the plan, we established the lines to follow to promote inclusive employment of people with disabilities during that period. In this session, I am going to present three things that we have been working on in the last time. First one is related to support measures for access to public policies, and also what we do with intellectual people with disabilities, intellectual disabilities. Our participation started with the origin of the specific reserve for intellectual disabled people. This started with the work that we did with the organization that it is in charge of disability nationally that depends on this general direction. So this office started requesting the general direction, this specific quota. So in the offer of public jobs in 2009, 10, and 11, the national direction reserved as a best practice a higher quota than the one that we have, that was it was a 5%. And the best practice was turned into a policy when we modified the law to increase the reserve quota from 5% to 7%. So at least as 2% of what was offered was reserved to be covered by people with mental disabilities. So this modification was taken care of in 2012. We elaborated it from the general direction, and we modified many other things to adapt them. In the year 2012, during the first call, we participated to be able to with the internal practice. We have had a great progress. We need to work with the Ministry of the State. We started working with executives from 2018, and we consolidated the different measures to be able to facilitate the access of the people with disabilities, mental disabilities, disabilities to, for employment, for public employment. So this is not just for what we're doing now, but for the selection process itself. We also recognize that there are aspects that are susceptible to improvement. So we need to keep on trying to make efforts to have a better participation of the people with disabilities, with mental disabilities in this election processes. So the offer for 2021 that was approved yesterday, and we saw that there was a reservation for the quota of people with disabilities. We have been trying to foster public hiring, and that is socially responsible as well. So in this policy, we have been trying to work specifically on the elaboration of the regulation that is going to be supervising all of this with the ministry that is the competent one. This policy is going to be based on the inclusion of criteria and social aspects that are related to public hiring. So we have proven that through this, the administrations can intervene at the same time in the economic development and in the social development of the country. In the contract of 2018, we incorporated several measures of employment for people with disabilities. For example, we forbid the hiring of companies that do not comply with the 2% quota for jobs for mentally disabled people or the alternatives for those. In the criteria of allocation to the contract, we included in the characteristics, in the social characteristics of the offer, things that are very much related to things that are have to do with sub hiring. So we include disposals that are related to the bidding processes and the hiring processes that we need to include universal accessibility. And we fix a minimum percentage of a hiring focused on employment from the general and management of employment in the 7% and 10%. Apart from that, in the general direction, we participated in the plan for boosting a social responsibly hiring. This is in the public aspect that was approved in 2019 with a finality, with the idea in mind of involving the right application of all of this. And the last thing that I am going to show you is related to promoting measures that are going to favor the access to employment of people that have intellectual disabilities. In general, we consider them as people that have mental disability, that limit mental disability, a person that has an IQ of lower, that is considered as general, and that also has difficulties in interacting with their environment. So that is going to make more difficult to for them to be developed in social aspects. These people do not are not part of the legal aspect, for the legal consideration of people that have that are considered as disabled in Spain. So they are not in the range. However, these are people that present several social problems that are even worse because of them trying to access the work market. So that is why the convention that I talked about before had a mandate that asked the government to present a series of measures that wanted to promote the access of employment of these people. The approval of this type of measures has taken more time than necessary. The general direction had a series of contacts with the general direction that is the one that is competent to taking all of this forward, but the final boost did not come to us until 2018, and the works have finished with the approval in May of this year with the royal decree to promote the access to employment of people with limit mental disabilities. So we have requirements for people to actually be the destinatories of these measures. So they have to be enrolled in the employment. And they also need to show that they have at least a 20% of mental disability without getting to the 33, that is the official one. So this is going to be valued according to the disability. The actions that we have, the positive actions that we have are the ones that are current, the common ones for disabled people that adapted. So we are going to apply subventions because of indefinite contracts, but less than what was established for people with disability. So for example, it's 2,000 euros instead of 3,900. So the subventions, the grants are also for the work posts. We also established a bonification in social security with indefinite contracts for people that have a disability. So it's 1,500 euros per year for 4 years. We include specifically these people in the support program for employment. And we also apply certain peculiarities for the learning part for people that have limit intellectual disabilities for their future employment. About the impact of this policy, we have calculated that 3,700 people could be part of these measures, and the financing is also sustained and insured because it depends on the labor ministry and also the autonomous communities that have this. Jobs, and it also depends on the security, social security budget. So here I'm sharing with you some examples of the implementation of the public policies for inclusive work in the last years. We have been working on the elaboration of the new Spanish strategy about disability from 2021-2030, and this will set the path for the work that we're going to be doing for disability in the next couple of years. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Laura, so much for your intervention, and thank you, every speaker, for these very interesting interventions. Now, I would like to do a small round of questions, just to delve deeper into some of the aspects that they have presented during their own interventions. In the first place, I would like to ask Antonio, Antonio that has presented this experience that's been very pioneer, has a great impact in Spain, and that refers to communities that receive all of these projects with different challenges. In this case, the penitentiary project and intellectual disability. Antonio, within that work, with the penitentiary and intellectual disability and their families, how you worked with these communities, how were you able to present this and develop it, and what challenges have you found? I believe that the key of this project is that we address especially vulnerable people. Besides living in very marginated environments and they have irregular behaviors, they are very vulnerable people that many times
they
don't even understand themselves sometimes, the reasons of their own behavior. So I believe that that particular vulnerability that these people have is easily understood from the general collective of disabled people and within the very penitentiary environment. I think that in that way, we haven't had many obstacles in the development. Maybe the biggest challenge that we said, that we've seen, is taking them out of the penitentiary institution. At first, the first thing that the program did was develop formative programs within the penitentiary institution. But when we decided to go a step further, so that these people could have the opportunity to step out of that facility to do another activity, that clashed with the resistance of the penitentiary authorities, because at the end, they have the perception that these are dangerous people and therefore may create these adjustments, them leaving the centers. And little by little, we've managed that resistance, and the support from APSA's professionals is very important, the work that's been done with the penitentiary authorities or of different institutions has made it that we can see it on another hand with tangible results that the project has, the advantages it has that to step out of the penitentiary facilities to do another activity, and we have overcome that resistance that I believe are the biggest challenge, the main difficulty that we've met in implementing this project. Now we've worked for over 20 years, so now we always receive different congratulations. Thank you, Antonio, so much. That's very interesting. I can see that this couldn't have been easy at some points. I would also like to ask specifically, Nadia, about one part of your presentation, about that first evaluation of the public policies and where you get the data. Where do you get the data of the situation of these people and the statistics that you use for implementing this project? This data gathering is very complex for everyone that works with disability. So I would like to ask you, Nadia, how do you solve that problem of data gathering in the United States when you work with local governments?
Thank you for the question. It's an ongoing challenge that we continually strive to address. But the U.S. Department of Labor, after several years of research in 2008, worked with other DOL agencies to include disability questions. The current population survey collects information on the employment of Americans, including those with disabilities. So at the state level, we recognize the importance of consistent, credible data and we're working with our intermediary organizations to address the issue. And working across the federal government with the DOL and other federal agencies. DOL has a number of research projects, including looking at women with disabilities, as well as the impact of COVID on people with disabilities. I encourage you to look at the DOL website for more data and resources. Thank you.
Thank you, Nadia. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Nadia. Thank you so much. That's right. That's one of the biggest challenges. But also, in the presentation that you provide, and maybe this question can be answered by Katia, you pointed out that you have a methodology to identify different trends and to be able to follow them, the track trends that showed in your presentation. Katia, what are those trends? Can you name the most important ones in employment matter when you work in this aspect?
Katia, tienes que encender el micrófono.
Katia, you need to turn your microphone on.
Thank you. Thank you for that question. We collect information as far as the requests that come to our initiative for policy assistance from the states. And over the course of the years from 2016 to 2019, we were able to establish the trends for those requests, which also lend themselves to the number of policies that have been introduced and enacted by the states. And overall, the majority of our requests or requests that have come in from the states for policy assistance, just about 60% was related to laying the groundwork, which are policies that communicate state and local level commitment to supporting workforce development and employment across the United States, and including the concept of state as a model employer. And this is very important because this is the largest trend that most states are attempting to be model employers, to showcase, you know, themselves as employers of people with disabilities. And in order to do that, there are various policies that can be enacted. So that is where we see the largest number of information requests, as well as the largest number of policies that are implemented. The second highest trend is around staying at work. So returning to work and staying at work. And this is even more relevant now with the pandemic and recovery policies. And basically staying at work simply is providing employers with tools to retain and advance workers when they are injured, acquire illness, or change in disability status occurs. So this is about keeping people in the labor, in labor participation and in the workforce. And so we see states implementing policies around stay at work, return to work. And the trend following those two categories, and about 10% of requests for each of these three categories are getting to work, preparing for work, and self-employment and entrepreneurship. Getting to work is exactly that. It's getting into and accessing work opportunities, so accessible transportation and accessible technology. Of course, as you know, with the pandemic, there's been a little bit of slow in the accessible transportation movement, but as far as accessible technology, we've seen an increase in requests around ensuring that telework is inclusive to all, which includes, you know, access to technology. Preparing for work, that's career readiness. That's youth and young adults transitioning to the workforce from, you know, education. And that also includes work-based learning opportunities. There is a significant movement in the United States around apprenticeships. And through our work, we try to promote and encourage inclusive apprenticeship programs. And this is a proven practice in providing an individual with the skills they need to perform a job and a career, and the employer with a skilled worker. And so there's been lots of programs, initiatives, and funding in the United States for apprenticeships. So we're seeing that also as an increasing trend. And finally, supporting self-employment and entrepreneurship. Working for yourself can be the most accommodating of all work opportunities. And so promoting self-employment and entrepreneurship is something that we see also trending in these policies. So ensuring that business owners with disabilities are given opportunities, whether it's in state government procurement or other procurement opportunities, including microloans and other types of initiatives.
Thank you, Katia. Muchas gracias por
Thank
tu respuesta.
Thank you, Katia, so much for your very interesting answer to identify these trends that also mark the different trends for public policies. Now we have a final question for Laura. Bet that you have for intellectual or disabled people opportunities.
In Spain, we
have a very important program for promoting this. But of course, it still has challenges. We are doing a great offer of jobs in Spain. That will be a challenge. So, Laura, how do you see this facing this big challenge for inclusion of intellectually disabled people? Well, the challenge here is to face it
with accessibility,
to eliminate, break every barrier. Not just the physical barriers, but cognitive barriers. But for this concrete, specific collective with intellectual disabilities are the ones that have bigger issues. They've been receiving less attention, although it's part of universal accessibility. According to this definition, it is true that in the regulations and in different public policies, ultimately, that's been left behind. So the government has recently approved
31 millones dentro del plan de
start of 31 million of accessible Spain to be able to solve these kinds of problems and provide, in this case, and favor public employment for people with intellectual disabilities, provide all opportunities and guarantee the right of a stable job and a worthy, dignified job as we state in different policies.
So,
from my point of view, that is the key, especially in the one that's
on
the next years.
The
Spanish strategy for disability also in favoring and promoting accessibility for people with cognitive disabilities. Thank you, Laura, so much. It's important to have equality and opportunities, and thank you for that intervention. I wanted to thank every one of our speakers for presenting their projects and to give us the opportunity to reflect a bit further
on
the employment subject. That's always a topic that's very present, but it's never reflected enough because still the data is still surprising and keeps bringing a lot of problems when we see that people with disabilities still face many barriers for entering the job market. We've had the opportunity to listen to Antonio with a very concrete, very clear project that's directed at a very specific population that over 20 years has allowed the success
and
a job reality for people with intellectual disabilities that came out of a penitentiary regime. And we had the opportunity to hear about the SEED project that addresses the entire United States to have different public entities and different governments to improve the quality of their public policies through a project that interchanges, detects trends, that provides data, and contributes to different realities. And at the same time, the effort of the Spanish government that through very concrete ideas tries to build bridges towards inclusion in employment with a very clear and
clear
and right policy. I would also like to thank our interpreters English, and Spanish, and sign language to be with us today. And again, thank you so much for listening into this session.